So, Wadah Khanfar, former Director General of the Al Jazeera Networks, he is currently the President of Al Sharq Forum. So, when he came in, I said to him, what is one thing I can share about you to the audience? And in his humbleness and humility, he just smiled and, you know, he said, the bio. And he came with a delegation, so I asked his delegation, what is one thing? Words like, he's a good man, he's a great man, came to mind. Somebody even said that he took one small channel in Arabic and he turned it to an international network of channels. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Mr. Wadah Khanfar.
Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. Thank you very much for this marvelous occasion. It is always great to come back to South Africa. I am partially South African, by the way. I spent 8 years in this beautiful country, and I learned a lot. And I owe a lot to what I achieved in life to my experience in South Africa and my warm and lovely relationship with this beautiful community of Muslims in this country. Regarding our brother Shaheen, our enthusiastic MC, I would like him to prepare himself because I'm going now to send him to a journey. All of us, we're going to send him to a journey in order to explore the path for us. So just eat your starter and prepare yourself. Now, you know, I have been, during the last few years, trying to figure out and to answer one question which I think this forum has been proposing for all of us: the future of Islam and the future of the Islamic world. Through that, we established many institutions. Al-Sharq Forum is one of them. And we are trying, actually, to explore the trends that could shape the way that we perceive the future. Therefore, we could position ourselves in that future. Now, I argue that the next 10 years of the human experience is going to be the moment of new birth of Homo sapiens. This is why I call the generation that's going to come Homo sapiens 2.0. Why am I arguing so? I'm going to send Shaheen back in time. Now, Shaheen is going to travel back to 6,000 years ago, the most documented civilization that we have uncovered lately in Iraq during the time of Hammurabi and the time of the Sumerian civilization. He will, not me, because now I will put him as a journalist landing in Babylon, trying to figure out exactly what's happening in Babylon. He will figure out that there is a government which has code of governance and legal structure. Very advanced, by the way. There is also structures in architecture that have been built during that time, 6,000 years ago, in a manner which makes the people of Babylon at that time aware very much of a lot of geometry, a lot of architecture and engineering that the humanity later on will implement. He will also figure out that the transportation system of the Babylonians is basically the one that, you know, you see in the movies maybe. They have the carriages, the horses, the mules, the donkeys, and they have the roads that have been established and structured during this period. Then he will figure out that when they fight, they will use the sword, they will use other also instruments and weapons that also maybe you are aware of because you have seen it through a lot of documentaries and dramas. Now, Shaheen will leave Babylon 6,000 years ago, and in that magnificent machine of traveling through time, he will land in Athens during the time of Alexander the Great, 332, he will land in Athens. He will discover, he will immediately figure out the structures, the architecture, which was similar to the Babylon. He will figure out the transportation mode. he will figure out even the governmental structures and the political structures with a bit of modification, because in Athens they will have a parliament in a way, and they will have something called democracy, headed by some great philosopher or introduced by someone called Plato, the Republic. And then he will figure out that when Alexander wanted to fight, he used the same weapons almost, plus a little bit of modification of what we call the Greek fire. It took the humanity a few thousand years to develop something called the Greek fire, but nothing really much. I did not see in history from 6,000 years, even before that, up to Alexander, a major departure from the conventional instruments and the customs and the traditions and political institutions that the humanity used. Then our brother Shaheen will travel back or forward in time. Then he will land in Rome during, let us say, maybe Augustus, 42 BC. And during that empire, he will discover exactly almost the same. Nothing changed, but a little bit of more authoritarian structure built by an empire, because the empire abandoned the Greek tradition of the Republic. They found it not convenient to be democratic all the time, so Augustus decided to be an authoritarian. But the same transportation mode, the same weapon that has been used 6,000 years ago, and the same as well structure of governing the land through authorities and the police and the structures and security and the army. Then you move forward into Persia, you know, where the Persian civilization, let us assume, I mean, I would say like 500 years later, you know, the beginning of the dynasty of the Sassanids, he will also almost witness the same. He will go to Mecca, 610. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Muhammad, has become the Prophet of Allah, 610, common era. And he will almost see similar. He will recognize the transportation through the camel and horses. He will recognize the war instruments. He will recognize the structures to a large extent. It will be familiar to him. It took the humanity at least 12,000 years from the beginning of the agricultural revolution to really depart from conventional methods of communication, transportation, and governance. It took the humanity really thousands of years. But if you come forward close to our time, which 17th century later on, the revolutions that started very quick, the Industrial Revolution, the Second Revolution, the Third Revolution, which is the electricity, the steam engine, then the, of course, electricity, and of course, the Information Revolution, the third one, which we are going through, you will figure out that the evolution of the methodologies and technologies has jumped in a rate which the humanity would have been impossible to envisage when our friend Shaheen was touring the world from the 6,000 years ago until the maybe 17th century, when it comes to the tools. What happened then? Immediately, the accumulation of this kind of culture, the accumulation of these technologies and tools, has led us to a moment of immediate explosion of ideas, of theories, of technologies, of sciences, and so on and so forth. That's reasonable. But again, it took us 100 years to develop the steam engine into something much more practical. It took us another 100 years to have the electricity and to have the car which was moving on four wheels. And it took us another 100 years to reach the information technology, which is reasonable. 100 years is a reasonable time in order to absorb change and in order to figure out how could you implement the ramifications of change on your social, cultural, political, and religious life. But from now on, or just from recently until the next 10 to 15 years, this slow and gradual evolution of tools and mechanisms and technology and methodologies will cease to have that rate. It will accelerate in a way that the human mind has never developed proper tools to cope with. This is why in the next 10 years, we are going to have the biggest challenge for every established norm and the tradition and culture and the structure that we accumulated since the beginning of the human colonies on Earth, which we dated 12,000 years ago through the agricultural revolution. Something new is going to be born. Why am I saying so? There are three trends that are unique in the human history, never happened before at all. The first one is related to the distribution of power. Distribution of power, since the humans built small agricultural villages in southern Turkey 12,000 years ago, has been always through a pyramid structure shape. So eventually you have the chief of the tribe, the chief of the village, the person who is on top, and then down to the end of the pyramid. That continued to be the case through states, empires, republics, and until today. But the rise of networking has developed something that the humanity never encountered: distribution of power in a vertical way. And this is the first time that the human mind is encountering this experience. It is not the pyramid that's going to rule the next 10 to 15 years. It is the networked reality that's going to replace it. I'm going to see this in my company. You will see it in your institution. You will see it in our families. You will see it in the government. You will see it in the companies. You will see it in the blockchain that our brother spoke about, and the Bitcoin that is emerging to disturb this pyramid structure of economy that has been established for the last 300 years through banking. There is something happening. The humans, since they discovered fire until today, they have never thought of power, but in a pyramid structure. Now they are going to think of it, our children and the grandchildren will think of it in a different way. The second one is the centralization of information. We have the decentralization of power, but we have the centralization, which through the artificial intelligence and the cloud and the big data. Now, this is amazing. For you as professionals, doctors, I am aware that maybe this matter has been discussed in your conference, because I would assume some of you, especially radiologists, are really keen to understand how can they move forward without losing their jobs. Because you know that the artificial intelligence is going to cancel a lot of jobs, especially in medicine, some medical, of course, specialties. I, of course, say radiology because this is the easiest way to make it automated right now. And then later on, the artificial intelligence, which for the first time in history is going to overtake the human intelligence by far. Of course, the rate previously we used to say from the 80s, according to Moore law, that every 18 months, the artificial intelligence is doubling. Right now, it is actually not in the 18 months, maybe in a few months, in 2 months, 3 months, it is doubling. We may, in 2023 to 2025, reach a moment of artificial intelligence doubling maybe every few days. It means by 2030, the amount of knowledge that the computers, the robots, or whatever we are going to have in the future will have is by far, by hundreds of times, much bigger than what the human mind could process or could have knowledge of. This is a huge challenge. We will lose a lot of jobs, a lot of people immediately now. We have the World Economic Forum declared 73 jobs in danger or about to be eradicated because of artificial intelligence. We are going to have definitely a lot of activities of the human being delegated to the machine. The machine here could be the robot, the smart computers, the quantum computers, whatever you call it. But definitely this is a major trend. I am not very much concerned tonight about the trend of what jobs, you know, the radiologists are going to have in the future. They are going to figure it out. But I am here going to discuss the ramifications of the fact that for the first time a human being could store his memory, adopt, you know, robots in interaction, and convert a lot of activities which are supposed to be intellectual to machines in order to take over rather than the humans. This is the second important trend to watch. The third trend, which I am really very concerned about, is actually biotechnology as well, because this is unique, never happened ever in history. And you know, as doctors, biotechnology is going to reshape the way that we think about our bodies. the way that before, always, we have our cell phones as an entity, separate from me. In the next 10 years, there will be no cell phone, there will be no computer, there will be no machine outside my body. Most likely, I will acquire certain kind of capabilities inserted, planted within me. And most likely, the way that we perceive the human body will change and shift. And therefore, the biotechnology, again, is a new trend that the humans never encountered in history. And this is going to happen. You know, I had the chance during the last 3-4 years to travel across the world and to visit a lot of laboratories, a lot of universities and institutions where the innovation and the creativity, forums. And I found that what we are talking about right now is not an imagination. It is not anymore fiction. It's actually what laboratories in most of the advanced developed countries are doing right now. Most of the investment last year on artificial intelligence went to build the robots that are going to outsmart the human being. So it's becoming a reality. It's not something it's not Uber anymore. It is actually something even might be more radical. Given these three, I don't want to go to the many other things in many other aspects. I will only stop here to contemplate very important matter. The future, as we envisage it for the humanity, because we are part of the humanity, is a continuous state of influx, a perpetual liquidity that does not allow us to gradually adapt to the new reality. It means whatever values, structures, including the family structure, the tribal structure, the cultural structure, whatever structure we have built, will be right now under very heavy, invasion of immediacy and of quick evolution. Now, in order to be able to adapt, you need to develop a new methodology. The humanity is not yet prepared for that because our mind has inherited the slow evolution technique that we have something called tradition and culture. And the tradition and culture, it means what? That there is inheritance of knowledge through some structures, we call it culture. But in the future, think about your children and your grandchildren, and then your grand-grandchildren, the way that the culture for them will be perceived, or the tradition that will be perceived, will be very far from what you perceived from your father and grandfather and grand-grandfather. It's going to be extremely different. And I argue, and I speak as a father, that maybe sometimes most of us cannot even communicate with our children, because of the new mindset that they are acquiring, the new skills, and the new way that they are thinking about. Coming to Islam, why I think Islam is, of course, there is a motto in the Arab world, unfortunately, and it has been under very heavy attack. Islam is the solution, you know? So why I really think that Islam is a solution for the dilemma of the perpetual liquidity and the state of continuous influx. Or flux, I do argue that there is something important going to happen in the future. The future, because of the speed of change, is not going to be built on culture, on a tradition, or on the inheritance of culture. It's going to be built on values, because values are above the practice of culture. And therefore, you can identify the value, and you can build around it very evolving techniques that could match the evolution of our environment and our context that we are going through. Islam has given us two important gifts. The Prophet ﷺ, before he died, he said, "Taraktu fikum ma in tamassaktum bihi, lan tadillu ba'di abada kitab Allahi wa sunnati." I have left with you two things that you will never go astray if you take hold of them. One of them is Kitabullah, and the second is my sunnah, my seerah, my tradition that I left for you. That's important. Why? Isn't it interesting to think that the only religion that came to earth and announced that it is the final communication, the final mission that the heavens will send, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send to earth, is Islam? Very interesting. No one ever claimed that before Muslims, before Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. No one said that I'm the final messenger and this book is valid until the day of judgment. No one said it. The fact that it was said, it implies the following message, that it is capable of continuing to be a source of guidance until the day of judgment. If it is not the source of guidance, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should send another messenger with another book. And this is what he did in the case of the Judaism and the Christianity. But in the case of Islam, he told us, be aware of the fact that there will be no book, no prophet after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and after Quran. Full stop. So I have that as a source. So it is continuous. So whenever there is a flux, whenever there is change of the pattern of the human evolution, at least I am left right now, for now, let us agree, I'm left with one consistent factor that divinely prescribed to us as a book of guidance, even in the age of artificial intelligence and biotechnology and networking and Mars and galaxy and black holes and wormholes and interstellar. Even if tomorrow our brother Shaheen is sent to Mars to establish a colony, which might be happening in the year 2032, he will find that this book is still valid as a book of guidance, even in Mars, not even on Earth. Why? Because Allah said so. He's not going to send another book. You have to figure it out. It is the book of guidance until the end of time. So that's we should establish as a major important prize for this ummah and for the world. Because the book was not sent for us, Muslims, and nas, for the people. Let us go to the third point. What kind of mechanism could we establish between these two great sources, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the seer of the Prophet, in our life to make it generate a discourse of guidance? That's important. This is lead us to discuss to what extent and how could we perceive the Quran in our life that could generate the solution for this kind of reality. It means, in my opinion, that the Quran is capable of generating meanings, tafsirs, through time. If you argue that this book that was interpreted by At-Tabari or Ibn Kathir or in the second or third or fourth generation, they have reached the final meaning of it, I would argue, then the context of what At-Tabari or Ibn Kathir or whoever did the tafsir at that time, they understand their context, they understood the Quran based on their context, and they made it the book of guidance in the second and third and fourth century of their lives. But I cannot take their understanding in my moving reality. It might not work. Therefore, I need to say the following statement. In order for us to have Islam as a religion of the future, think of Islam as a religion that is residing in the future, not in the past or in history. Dissociate the concept of continuity, of generation, of meaning of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is eternal until the day of judgment, from the fact that it is historically created a golden era for us. That is true. It created the golden era of Islam for us because our great scholars of the past understood it when they understood their context and their reality and their contemporary, needs. And they were able to make the book the book of guidance. Therefore, I will reach the following statement. This book, which does not change, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the book from Surah Al-Fatiha to Surah Al-Nas. Not a single letter can be changing until the day of judgment. The book does not change. But the meaning generates over time new solutions, new guidance to the humanity. This is why Allah described it, subhanahu wa ta'ala, annahu kitabun Quranun kareem. The word kareem means what? It is generous. Generous in what sense? Because of the continuity of giving. Because generosity here is a continuity of giving. It did not give a meaning and stopped giving, and therefore we have to go and memorize what others have said about it. It is you who should dig deep in it in order to find the generosity of it for the 21st and 22nd, 23rd, and the 3,000 years to come. This will become a book of guidance. We need to understand Islam and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in these kind of lights. Then I will move to the next point. What is the book? Yahi, this book, Al-Quran al-Kareem, when I read about it, I find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the words ayah. Allah said that Allah sent to you, O Muhammad, ayat, bayinat, ayat, verses. But he said to us, don't you look around at the ayat of Allah in the universe? What? It means there is an ayah in the universe. There is an ayah in the book. And he said to us, don't you think about the ayahs in yourselves? Then there are three categories of ayahs. There are three books. The book of this universe and the horizon. سَنُرِيهِمْ آيَاتِنَا. We shall show them our ayahs. فِي الْآفَاقِ, in the horizon. What are the horizons? Astronomy. From astronomy to subatomic particles, these are horizons. وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ, and in their selves. Psychology, the build-up of the human being, the spiritual, the social, the anthropological, all of those is related to man or the human being. And these are ayat. And then we have the ayat of the book. It is only the future. Is only when you are aware of the ayat of Allah in the universe, aware of the ayat of Allah in yourselves, and aware in the ayat of Allah in that book. These are the three major factors that will help us together in the future to lead with value-centered paradigm, globally oriented, not for the ummah of Islam, but for the humanity that will soon not find a path of values to contain the speed of change. This is why, if I am speaking about one book in three revelations, one of them through the ayahs, the laws that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this universe. This is why, ya akhi, advise your children, please, to study physics, astronomy, quantum physics. Let them explore the beauty of the ayahs of Allah in this universe. Tell your children to study psychology and to study the human sciences. These are the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ourselves and in our societies. And tell your children to study with all of that the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. This kind of unity between these three major streams will generate a meaning that has never being generated to another ummah. And this is how this book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will unlock the mysteries of the universe, the mysteries of the selves, regardless of the phases of change and the speed that we are going to go through. Otherwise, I am going to give this warning. The next generation will never listen to us. Simple. They might come to us out of respect, to ask for consultation, attend our mosques, speak to our elders, but later on, they are going to go do whatever they are going to do. Their relationship with space and time has shifted. Their definition of nationalism, religiosity, communication with each other is going to shift. Social media, social structures, everything is going to be shaken. Therefore, we need this dynamic approach to future through the lenses of through the Quran and the understanding of this mobility of the meaning of Quran rather than the static meaning of Quran. I will just end because our brother Shaheen has come back from Mars and he is now keen to stop me. Now, I would like to end with the following statement. This is about Quran. What about Seerah? After I left Al Jazeera as a journalist, I decided the following adventure. I did exactly like what we did with Shaheen. I decided to go live in Mecca from the year 500. And I studied as a journalist, now again, because I was trying to study the same rules of journalism that implement in geopolitical, cultural structures. When I was reporting to Al Jazeera, I wanted to implement the same meaning in Mecca in the year 500. 500 why? Because Hashim, the grandfather of the Prophet ﷺ, was around and he was trying to build a new structure in Mecca. And this is how Mecca became important as a trade center during the early time of the Constantinople and Persia. I lived this period, 100 years, through the sources of Islam, which is very few, unfortunately, because before the birth of the Prophet, very few resources we have, but through, actually, the Byzantine, Persian, and Ethiopian histories, which complement the picture of the world in the year 500, up to the year 610, when the Prophet became a prophet. Of course, he was born 572. Now, during this period, I wanted to understand, I'm coming up now, a work that I've done called the First Spring. After the Arab Spring failure, I came up with a study called the First Spring, and I mean the life of the Prophet ﷺ because he was born in al-Rabi' al-Awwal, Rabi' Spring, the First Spring. So our First Spring of the character of the Prophet ﷺ as a prophet, as a leader, and as someone who has created the most important transformation in the human history. The structure of power by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam shifted from the structure of monopoly, which the Romans and the Persians and the Aksumites did, to the structure of sharing. This is the first time in history, never happened before. The structure of wealth shifted from accumulation to spending. The structure of social communication, social life, shifted from interest, cultural, tribal-based into brotherhood system. Again, an equality-based structure with just system. Now, that departure from the past to the future happened there in Mecca. This is why I argue, and I think, you know, all of you might agree, that whatever called later on as Enlightenment or Renaissance, the roots of it, the seeds of it, started 610 in Mecca. Without it, the human mind would have continued to be imprisoned in the tradition of thousands of years of accumulation of power and monopoly of wealth. But that trigger started in Mecca 610, evolved, not in the Islamic world only, but even in the Western world, into something else. And then we transferred through Andalusia to the West our values of that time. The time has come now for a second evolution that we lead. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did it 1,400 years. And he was able to introduce to us magnificent evolution of everything. Human race evolved, culture, technology, astronomy. We departed from mystery into reality. We departed from doubt into science. We departed from decay into consolidation. Are we capable of having the Prophet with us right now in order to adopt this new evolution, revolution, generation of new paradigms and imagination? And our great Qari, just a few minutes ago, he told us, he recited to us the ayah that said, وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ فِيكُمْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Wallahi, this ayah, when I heard it, I was shaking. Why? He doesn't tell us, وَعْلَمُوا, that I have sent to you, Muhammad Rasulullah. He said, be informed that amongst you is Rasulullah. What does that tell you? That he is continuously present in the life of this ummah. He is not history. He has that continuity through his seerah. This is when you understand seerah, start and understand it with the lens of continuity, not the lens of the past. If he was with us, as the ayah is telling us, then he will comprehend all these trends and will prescribe to us the medicine that will take us out of it. اعلموا أن فيكم رسول الله. والله, this is the best answer to what we are talking about. We need this seerah of the Prophet ﷺ to be transferred from lovely stories that resemble our love to his person into a methodology of rise of a new dawn, not for Muslims, for the humanity. For the humanity. He said to us in 610 in Mecca, when Quraysh, that small tiny village of 5,000 inhabitants, which was disconnected almost from everywhere in the world, imagine Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam living there amongst his tribe, and suddenly the Quran reveals to him the following ayah: وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَّةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا. Wallahi, if I were him, I will collapse. What are you talking about? I mean, I am living with these few hundred people in Mecca, and you are telling me, you are the prophet, كَافَّةً لِلنَّاسِ, for the entire humanity, for the Chinese, for the Africans, for the Latinos of that time, for whoever is living anywhere. How on earth his person received that magnificent mandate? That mandate is much more applicable to Muhammad amongst us today, not the time of Mecca. And now the Prophet who is amongst us, as the Quran is telling us, is again telling us that I am a prophet for humanity. We need to destroy the bridges that we have, destroy the trenches and build the bridges with the humanity. We stop thinking of ourselves in the term of minority, in the term of marginalized, victimized, conspired against, and assume the new value of leadership through the values that we can develop to save not ourselves, the world. Because we cannot save ourselves alone. The world itself should be saved with us. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
MashaAllah.